with turtle doves, Bill and Coo, when they love. That's the kind of magic music we make with our lips when we kiss. And there's a weepy old willow, he really knows how to cry. That's how I'd cry on my pillow if you should tell me farewell and goodbye. Lullaby, birdland, whisper low, kiss me sweet. And we'll go flying high in birdland, high in the sky up above, all because we're in love.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Open Mic Night at the Strong Badger Coffee House.
Yay!
everyone's seen Monty Python and the Holy Grail, right? Anyway, some people don't get that joke. I'm not looking at anyone in particular, but I'm looking at someone in particular. Anyway, thank you all for coming out this evening. We have an excellent, if you know, slightly short lineup, so we may go around the block again. But to start things off, we're going to have Don McKenzie, Mr. Don over here, and Joe is on deck. Joe,
I'm on deck.
You're on. I know you sign up in the number four spot, and then suddenly you're on deck. It's crazy. I don't know.
So we're gonna start off with some Hank. When leaves begin to die. That means he's lost the will to live. I'm so lonesome I could cry. The silence of a falling star lights up a purple sky. And as I wonder where you are, I'm so lonesome I could cry. We'll stick with Hank. I tried so hard, my dear, to show that you're my every dream. Yet you're afraid each thing I do is just some evil scheme. A memory from your lonesome past keeps us so far apart. Why can't I free your doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart? Another love before my time made your heart sad and blue. And so my heart is paying now for things I didn't do. In anger, unkind words are said that make the teardrops start. Why can't I free your doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart? There was a time when I believed that you belonged to me, but now I know your heart is shackled to a memory. The more I learn to care for you, the more we drift apart. Why can't I free your doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart? Finish off with some Johnny. Well, you wonder why I always dress in black, why you never see bright colors on my back, and why does my appearance seem to have a somber tone? Well, there's a reason for the things that I have on. I wear the black for the poor and the beaten down, living in the hopeless, hungry side of town. I wear it for the prisoner who has long paid for his crime, but is there because he's a victim of the times. I wear the black for those who've never read or listened to the words that Jesus said about the road to happiness through love and charity. Why, you'd think he's talking straight to you and me. Well, we're doing mighty fine, I do suppose, in our streak of lightning cars and fancy clothes. But just so we're reminded of the ones who are held back, up front there ought to be a man in black. I wear it for the sick and lonely old, for the reckless ones whose bad trip left them cold. I wear the black in mourning for the lives that could have been. Each week we lose 100 fine young men. And I'll wear it for the thousands who have died, believing that the Lord was on their side. And I'll wear it for another 100,000 who have died, believing that we all were on their side. Well, there's things that never will be right, I know, and things need changing everywhere you go. But till we start to make a move to make a few things right, you'll never see me wear a suit of white. Oh, I'd love to wear a rainbow every day and tell the world that everything's okay. But I'll try to carry off a little darkness on my back till things are brighter. I'm the man in black.
Thank you so much, Don. Always a pleasure. I am going to call Mr. Joe Davis up to the stage. Joe will be performing next Saturday at 2 o'clock as part of our Victor Street Block Party Badger Fest festivities. Is that what I said? Okay, that sounds good. Yeah. Yeah, well, we'll try to squeeze him in. Yeah, that's what I've been calling it in my head. So we're going to hear from Joe Davis, and Kent is on deck. Kent, you are on deck. But first we're going to hear from Joe, and I'm going to take a minute to get him set up because Joe's got a pretty...
I have a special guest playing.
I blow into the mic to make sure it works.
All right, so yes, I'm playing with my friend Loopy here tonight.
No, that's his nickname. His real name is Nano Looper 360. Okay, I'm gonna tell you what I'm gonna do here. I'm only gonna play one song tonight, but it'll probably take all my 10 minutes. So, I tried to write a song and tell a story and play guitar in the background, but I didn't have the skills to do that. So I decided this afternoon I was going to play on the loopy thing, and I would play it and then press the button, and then it would keep playing what I just played, and then I would be able to concentrate. So I'm going to just show you that it truly is me who's playing what's on the loopy thing. First of all, I got to test it, because if the technology doesn't work, then it can be embarrassing. That was me this afternoon. I think we might have to turn that up a tad. There we go. So anyway, that's the little loopy thing that I did. I think I'll just keep it going there, Brock. extensions are super awesome. So when I was a little boy of 8 years old, I lived in Germany with a military family. And we were then transferred to Winnipeg. And I asked my dad, well, where's Winnipeg anyway? We were originally from the Maritimes, and I never heard of Winnipeg before. And he said it was right smack dab in the middle of Canada. It's really flat, it's hot, and it's some cold in the winter, boy. I would learn later that it's no different than Omaha, Tulsa, or Sioux City, any other small Midwestern city. It's just that the people in Winnipeg don't have funny accents, American, Maritime, or otherwise. A? Oh yeah, I forgot about the A. So we'll fast forward a few decades here. So right smack dab in the middle of Winnipeg is a place where people of the neighborhood would gather for a visit, where they would dash in and pick up their morning choice variety of caffeine product. It was a tiny, unassuming place, but it welcomed all who were tired and thirsty or needed a bit of conversation and cheering up. Now, every second Friday night was a special night at this little establishment. If you weren't at least a half an hour early, you probably wouldn't get a seat, except for tonight. That was not the case tonight. I was really hoping this would play out, you know, but it didn't quite. You know the event, it's the open mic night at the Strong Badger Coffee House. That's where the poets, yeah. The poets and the singers, the guitar strummers and pickers, the plunkers of countless stringed instruments and shakers and strikers of various items that can be bought at the dollar store, went to enjoy an evening out. Occasionally, the odd harmonica player would join in a song from his special chair that was duly determined to be his, and he is not in it tonight. You guys know who I'm talking about. Brock was the owner. He was a connoisseur of all things caffeine, and what really attracted me to him was his calm demeanor as he oftentimes stood poised and eager behind the upright bass. See? There he is. An item that was as part of the furniture as any chair or homemade table. He was knowledgeable in classical, jazz, and bluegrass, and all things in between. Sarah was his lovely assistant. She would make sure that the till kept ringing and everyone was fed and watered while Brock was off hosting the show. Brock has a sign-up sheet, and for some strange reason, everyone usually avoids going number 4. So typically, that's where I slot in, except for tonight, I got put up to 2. That's where I get to practice my crafts of singing, learning the banjo, even if it's not Scrugg style, working on my guitar picking and telling stories. In fact, I'm going to pause the story here and add some flavorful guitar licks. Complete without meeting the characters involved. So my apologies to those who I've missed, but I did do the attendance. I did do the attendance before I got up here, and if someone came in late, like that guy, his name is Dave, by the way, or doesn't get a mention, you have my deepest sympathies. Slots 1 and 2 often went to the poets and the readers of short stories and a cappella singers. Chris would tell poems about trees or cookie making. I didn't know it was possible to write about trees, but he would argue otherwise. And then there's Donald. He's kind of sitting out there in a wing. He would sing a cappella, and his favorites, as you know, were Old Hank, Kris Kristofferson, Patsy Cline, and Elvis. Is Wilf here yet? No, he's not here yet? That's terrible. Okay, well, anyway, I'll tell a story about Wilf. Wilf would recite poems and often write them right here, right out there in the wing, and present it, freshly scribbled down and eager and ready for an eager audience to consume. Much the same way as a baker takes buns out of the oven and gives you a couple on a plate with butter and jam to share with an old friend. He sang a bit as well. By the way, I'm talking about Wilf. His a cappella rendition of Up on the Roof is a Strong Badger classic and one of my favorites. Usually the last act, about number 8, was a seasoned veteran of the small stage, namely Rick or Derek. Not as many people are here tonight as I thought. Rick was a cool dude who had memorized at least 200 songs and never needed the words. He was skillful and highly sought after singer and guitar player. He is a humble man. He's the type of person that you'd love to sit and chat with over a couple of Brock's Americano and one of those great big sugar cookies. Then there's Derek. He's handicapped. Yeah, he's handicapped in some way because he actually needs 3 hands. 2 to play the guitar and 1 to work that confounded tablet thing of his. You guys all know what I'm talking about. We should take a collection for him so that we can help him buy the technology. That way, what's that? That's a good idea. I think I'll suggest that. That way he can live a normal life again. He loved Willie Nelson and he never failed to get others up to join him. And you bet I was first to jump up and pick along and sing along. Tell something about almost every single person in this room tonight, so you better be patient. Then there was this special group of people, a whole bunch of them. There were, last count, there was 6 women and 5 men. Usually the same 2, 3, or 4 came up, but I've seen every one of them up there at least once. So I'm going to recite some names here. There's Paul, Marilyn, Lydia, Eldon, and Linda. They were the ones you would expect to get up. But then there's Lyle, Wade, Cal, Bev, Penny, and Verda would sometimes surprise us pleasantly and not to be counted out. Jim and Jeannie, what? Whoa, they were a newly retired couple with voices of angels. When they sang together, I always had this overwhelming urge to run home, grab my classical guitar, and play Marty Robbins licks, all on horseback with a 6-shooter at my side. Then there was Dave. He's reading a book right now, by the way. And I'm sure he sounds like a recording from the 30s. The first song I ever heard him play was Travelin'. Although he's very funny, there's a serious player in there. He plays guitar, banjo, and dobro, and is especially fond of the slide guitar. So, Dave, what are you playing tonight? Oh, you're reading, eh? Okay. So, to those who I haven't mentioned, Gloria, Vic, Renee, where did he go? And there's somebody there, I don't know your name. Yeah. Lady in the white shirt. Bev. Hi, Bev. Wade, you are Kent. I got it written down, you see. I'm a teacher, so. So if you ask me what I want to do when I grow up, I'll just smile and say, I think I'd like to go number 8 at the Strong Badger. I don't know if I should have called that the Strong Badger song or the descending E scale chords song. Anybody? If so, I apologize.
Thanks so much, Joe. That was extremely special. My gosh. I'm going to have to go back and listen to that one 5 or 10 more times. All right. So Ken Desart, I don't even have to call him up. He's already on the stage, which is pretty fantastic. And Mr. Dave is on deck. It's going to be an adventure, I'm sure. But we're going to hear from Kent, everyone.
Put the cape on the second fret because that was what was happening before. So, and how strong is the badger?
Extremely strong.
Yeah.
We're gonna risk that.
Should I play one of my songs? Ooh, it's hot. Thank you.
Smile on your brother, everybody get together. Gotta love one another right now.
Oh, thanks so much, Kent. That was fantastic. Great to hear from you. Let's hear it one more time for Kent if you want to hear him back here, guys. Yeah. All right. Now we've come to the part of the evening where we put Dave on the spot. Well, that's the thing. That's the question. Some kind of spot. You might put me on the spot in return. We'll see.
Of the t-shirts.
Read or die.
Read or die. So I'll try to read. Joel already demonstrated a really excellent way of putting prose and music together. I'll demonstrate a slightly less excellent one, kind of more beatnik-y. And Brock will make up for anything I'm not doing because he's going to sound great. Like he's got a good beatnik beard going. We just need some berets. And a proper goatee. No, I'm going to read from this book I got when I walked in one day. I believe Richard one day found this book and Brock had it. And he's like, oh, here you go. And I haven't really actually read it properly from beginning to end. I just keep opening it up and finding places in it. And I'll just randomly open the places I've sort of accidentally marked that might be funny. Chapter 1, what is a cat? Cat - noun / comma thing, K-A-T, unslash. A, a carnivorous mammal, Felis cactus, catus, long domesticated as a pet for catching rodents. B, companion of humans, noted for its pointy ears, comma, whiskers, comma, and long cat-like tail. C, a cool jazz musician, known for being well-dressed, comma, good at playing brass instruments, comma, and also having a way with the ladies. Have I got your attention now? Have you already learned something that you didn't know before? Okay, now this is just reading the book here, so I don't know. There's a bit of cat history, but let's move along here to somewhere deeper into the, just a random. Oh, that's a cat quiz. I took that and I'm actually an E, but never mind. Let's see. I have no idea if this will be good. So, choosing your ideal cat mate. A lot of guys think that choosing a cat is as easy as sticking their hand into a box of kittens and hoping for the best. This could not be further from the truth. It's actually more difficult to find a good cat mate than a human soulmate. Why? Because when humans first meet, they are able to use language to exchange basic vital information like, I'm an outdoorsy gal, or I'm not so much into spy movies, or I suffer from night terrors. This information helps determine compatibility. When it comes to choosing your cat, you'll need to make an educated guess. So let's get you educated. And then there's a long section of quizzes here, which I don't think I should take you through because it's quite something. How about just, okay, you get the idea. Cats are special. You got to really be into them. Rolfing, camping. How about the Brock party thing? Hair and fashion. Chapter 16. I have no idea what we're going to come across, but now that you mastered the basics of cat ownership, we'll presume you've read all this already, it's time to have a little fun. Your cat isn't just your new best friend and a symbol of your growth as a man. He's also a beautiful animal that deserves to be admired by the world. Your cat's defining feature is, of course, its beautiful coat of fur. Let's examine it and see what the possibilities are, not just for health and maintenance, but even perhaps a little pizzazz. And there's a little bit of information on shedding. Why do cats shed so much? Shedding is a natural process for most cats. It allows them to moderate the body temperature at different times of the year. If you lived outdoors with your cat, you'd barely notice the shedding. It's only because the cat is indoors and sitting on your new brush suede love seat that you even noticed it. If shedding is becoming an annoyance, you can talk to your cat about stepping outside when he needs to shed. But it's probably better to accept the slight inconvenience and stay on top of your cleaning. I recommend twice a week vacuuming and keeping a supply of lint rollers to spot cleanups. Okay, for spot cleanups. There's one more tiny chapter paragraph. Anxious cats may also shed more than normal. So if you feel that fur piles are abnormal, talk to your cat and see if anything's eating at them. And of course, older cats may just be naturally losing their hair, a condition known as male cattern baldness. Then you get some cat pictures with hairdos. We'll put them up later. And see what the napkin will pull up. There's one just in front of it. Okay, this could be good. I hope it's good. This beatnik business is tough. Joe did it so well. It made it look very easy. Okay. How to tell if your cat is hooked on drugs. You gotta know, I haven't really read this deeply, so this is all first for me to hear. Okay, your cat may belong to you, but the choices he makes are his. And his alone. He makes are his own. Okay. And sometimes those choices will have dangerous consequences. Did you know that one in every 1.5 cats will experiment with drugs at some point in their lives? Are you ready to help your little guy if he becomes a statistic? Because before you can help him, you need to be able to recognize the warning signs. And let's see what some warning signs are. Ooh. Not sure if you can see that. He's doing cat gang things. He's got stuff. Yeah, he's got a gang sign. Okay. The DARE program was one of the most successful anti-drug initiatives in the history of our nation. It has saved countless teens from a life of drugs, alcohol, and despair. Unfortunately, your cat doesn't attend public school. You two haven't been able to build up a bond of trust with the help of local police officers. Your cat may be on drugs. These are some of the warning signs. She's withdrawn, depressed, tired, and careless about personal grooming. She's hostile and uncooperative. He frequently knocks the lamp over. He's hanging around with a new group of friends. He's hanging around with a group of drug addicts. Her grades have slipped, and her school attendance is irregular. He's lost interest in hobbies, sports, and other favorite activities. Her eating or sleeping patterns have changed. She's up at night and sleeps during the day. Definitely a drug cat. He has a hard time concentrating. He is checking on Foursquare at known drug hangout spots. He gets phone calls. He has either gained or lost substantial weight. He's been listening to Pink Floyd with his bedroom door closed. He has sewn rock band patches onto his ripped denim jacket. She only wants a bunch of those Magic Eyes posters for Christmas. A couple more here. Her eyes are red-rimmed and or her nose is runny in the absence of a cold. And the last one, a tip. Household money has been disappearing. Let's see. I think one more mildly relevant thing could be of interest. Responsible cat hoarding. If you're good at something, you should do it as much as possible. That makes sense, right?
Yeah.
The truly successful in our world find their talents and commit their lives to it. Just look at race car drivers, teachers, bridge builders, etc. So if you are such a kick-ass cat owner, why on earth are you squandering your talents on just one cat? Jazz hole. And how many cats should I own? Tough question, because owning multiple cats is a slippery slope. Two cats is twice as many as one cat, but three cats is only one more than two. Once you get to five or six, you won't even notice the difference in the quality of your life and state of your home. Try not to get bogged down in the math and go with your gut. Without meeting you personally, I'd recommend you own no more than 15 cats. Just a little bit more. Before bringing in any new cats in your home, it's vital that you discuss the impending changes with your original primary cat. He may have some reservations. Listen to his concerns and assure him that no matter how many dozens of cats end up living with you guys, you two will always have a tight bond. He's your first and only true love. And no amount of additional cats will ever change that until he dies. Okay, I better stop there. Thank you for learning about cats with me. Thank you, Brock. Thank you, Joseph.
I think we should take this show on the road. I think, like, you know, Carnegie Hall would book us, right? Pretty sure. All right, and in keeping with the theme of putting people on the spot, right as soon as he walks in the door, I'm going to get Ariel, right? Have I got... Okay, good, because my brain is not 100%. All there, but he's gonna get some poems going as soon as I get a setup that'll work for him here. And is there anybody else who would like to? Wilf, are you thinking? He's got a. I've got some copies of Wilf's book that I just got dropped off. So maybe he'll give us a little sneak peek. Jim and Jeannie, are you? No. Okay. Well, yeah, I think we might put Joe back on too. We'll see. I should give, in fairness, I should give Don the next bite at it. So I'll swing over there. And anyhow, we'll hear from Mario first.
Okay. Yeah. Cool. Good. Cool. Okay, so
Awesome.
We're going to do a few, we'll do some poetry. A lot of them are really short, so if it ends really quickly, it has come to an end. The first one is actually one of the longer ones. It's called A Mother's Lament. Take me and my heart will remain pulsating red on barren rocks. The sea may take people, but the city will too. I went there once, the city was loud, claustrophobic people rushing here, there. There's a harpoon lodged in me that the sea cast. There's selkie blood in my family, my great-grandmother once said. Maybe I'll find the seal skin, gray speckled, leave you behind, hunt fish in the ocean. Maybe I don't want to go. The sea may take people, but there is something beautiful and ice floating in the spring. Yeah. Second one is, yeah. This is one of the really short ones, and it's titled You're Beautiful. Time wears you down like a seashell. What is left of me holds what is left of you. Like the inside of an abalone shell, you are still beautiful. Next one doesn't have a title. I'm finding a lot of my ones I've been writing just don't have titles, so this is just one of them. Lone cowboy riding across the mesa. He saved the town, kissed the girl like they knew he was gonna. And now he's riding off into the sunset. Tumbleweed tumbling, stops, observes, moves on. And now he's riding off into the sunset. Maybe if he rides far enough past the lonely coyote's howls, he'll be able to touch the sun, feel his hands burn in its soft red. Next one is called Low Tide. We hold each other close, your irises, dark blue oceans. The smallest movement creates waves in them. Black flecks in your seas like the backs of whales rising up for breath. We slip into sleep like a seal into water, submerged under sheets, our breath, rhythmic as ocean swells. Next one is, again, one of the untitled ones, so it does not have a title at all. A man walks into space, into the cord tethers him to the rocket, whispers to him, remember where you came from, your world bursting at the seams with sound, and he steps into the tethering cord, whispers, remember, but... And they pull back where he came from, back on his clamorous earth, pull. People are searching for out beyond the crackling atmosphere. Pull, pull him back in. Ask him about space still clings to him, and he says he doesn't want to break it. Yeah, so... We got three more to go. Next one is another one of the untitled ones. When a lamb says ma, ma means mum, ma means I'm hungry, ma means wait for me, I'm coming. When a ewe or ram says ba, ba means hungry, thirsty, are you all right? Ba means be careful, enough roughhousing. Ba means I love you, my little ball of wool. Ma, ba. What do they mean in the slaughterhouse? The next one is called A Farmer's Promise. I went to Wales this year and it was great. So there were a ton of sheep everywhere. So I got a few sheep poems out of it. Yeah, so it's titled A Farmer's Promise. I want to cherish you like the grass cherishes strands of wool after the shearing. And last one, it doesn't have a title. I think there's gonna be a title, but I don't know yet. Candle flame collapses, this is the end of the world. Smoke dances in corroding air, saturated with fear. In this moment, maybe there's a little more hope that the bolted, rusting door will keep the world out.
Thanks, Ariel. It's great to see you again. I feel like it's been a while. Were you in Wales, literally? Like, oh, okay. So that's where you went. Okay. All right. So there's some kind of rehearsing going on back there. I don't know what the heck. It makes me a little nervous when they're doing wacky stuff back there. But I'm gonna tentatively. It's Wilf. It's Wilf. Wilf. Yeah. I need a joke book for times like this. Or something. Dave's got the joke book. Oh, he's putting cats in my face.
Will you give us some poetry? No, he's
really not. Wilf. Wilf. There he is. Here's Wilf and possibly Joe. All right. I got it over here, Joe.
I'll just do a quick introduction here.
Oh yeah, you do that.
Okay,
yeah.
Well, you're hot. Joe is almost hot.
I'm hot.
Almost.
Hot. Whoa. Hot.
Sorry.
Yeah. Whoa, that knocked me over.
That was
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah. I hadn't planned on doing Paul Simon, but in a way, it's kind of penance. In my book, I misquoted him. I said a mother and child reunion is only an ocean away instead of a motion away, and I did the same thing as a kid when I said my body lies over the ocean instead of my Bonnie lies over the ocean. So I just kind of wanted to get that out of the way, and I'll try to sing a Paul Simon "Slip Sliding Away" here. There we go.
Slip sliding away. Slip
days when I lie in bed and think of things that might have been. And she slips sliding away. Slips sliding away.
Well, I get to play again. That's really awesome. Thank you, Will. I've made a career out of being impromptu. I once made a vow when I was a young man that I would never do this song. And I'm going back on my vow right now. And it's one of the top 10 campfire songs of all time. And I think I might have even done this song here. I don't know. It's called Take Me Home, Country Roads. In the key of G, my man. Here we go with the dollar store things that you hit and beat. I think I'll play it a little bit faster, shall we? Let's go. I'll try it again. You were following me, so I was going too slow. Here we go. That feels better. Yeah.
country road. Take me home to the place I belong, West Virginia. Take me home, country road. All my memories gather round her. Miner's lady, stranger to blue water. Dark and dusty, painted on the sky. Misty taste of moonshine, teardrops in my.
Guitar picking at the end. I can't resist.
So there's some background vocals in this one. This is one by, he's that old rocker who just died. What's his name? Tom Petty. Yeah, Tom Petty. Oh, you know what I need? Well, that's true. He's not too old, but you know what I need is a capo. Does anybody have one? There's one in my guitar case, and it's out there in a side room over there. Because otherwise, I'd have to play this really hard key. Actually, this is an E. I'll play it C at 4. Here comes the capo. This device is just an amazing device. You should all get one, whether you play guitar or not. Yeah. Where'd you get it? I bought it at Long and McQuaid, yep. What's that? It does, yeah, it does. It does that if I needed to hang up my clothes. Well, it started out down our dirty road. It started out all alone, and the sun went down as I crossed that hill, and the town lit up, and the world got still. Turn, and the rocks might. is the hardest thing. I'm gonna skip the lead solo here to save you all some grief. And some say life will break you down. It'll break your to some my city councilor and tell him or her that I got to play twice tonight. Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Actually, I don't even know if it's a him or her, so yeah, that'll tell you a little bit about me.
Thanks, Joe. I'm gonna call Marilyn and Lydia on up. They've got a spontaneous thing for us. And then after that, Donald is going to give us two more. But first, we're going to hear from Lydia and Marilyn.
Well, there's a special young lady amongst us today that had a big birthday. She had a big birthday on Wednesday, and so we had to send her this little song, and we did, but we thought we'd do a redo tonight.
So this is dedicated to Penny. Let's give it up for Penny. You know, those decade birthdays are always special. So we'll let you guys guess which one, which decade it is. 40.
40?
40.
40.
The wine, she said, not kind.
Wade, her
lover.
he emailed some of us a great idea of, let's send Penny some emails during the day of creative expressions of our love for her. So Linda and Cal put out cat treats in the shape of Happy Birthday Penny, and then she filmed them eating the treats.
Cal and Linda, not their cats.
Yeah. Cal and Linda ate the leftovers. And their kids did really cool stuff. So Marilyn and I audio taped this song. So we're gonna sing it for you.
This is with the visual.
So I hope we remember the lyrics. So I think it's good.
Okay.
Okay. So it's dedicated to Penny.
A, you're adorable. B, you're so beautiful.
beautiful sea. You're a cutie full of charm. D, you're delightful, and E, you're exciting, and F, you're a feather in Wade's arms. G, you look good to me. H, you're so heavenly. I, you're the one I idolize. J, you're like Jack and Jill. K, you're so kissable. L, you're the love light in my eyes. M, N, O, P, I could go on all day. Q, R, S, T, alphabetically speaking. Penny, you're okay. You make my life complete. V means so very sweet. W, X, Y, and Z. It's fun to wander through the alphabet with you and tell you what you mean to me.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
Thanks for that year.
See, it stuck in my head. When was your birthday, Benny?
It was on Wednesday.
Aw, happy birthday. That's fantastic. Well, thanks for sharing that, you guys. I'm going to call Donald up to do a couple more for us. Kent, do you have two more? Yeah? All right, so then we'll get Kent to do two to close us off, and that'll do her for the evening, but first we're going to get Don to do a pair more. Yeah?
Hey, okay, that works. I don't know if it's a good thing that the sound engineer turns you off when you step up to the microphone. I'm not exactly sure what he's trying to say there. But so hearing Country Roads being sung brought me back to this song that was probably one of the first songs that hearing this song made me want to sing. And it was a recording by Placido Domingo. And I received that album for Christmas, 30 years ago or so. But this is another John Denver song. You fill up my senses like a night in the forest, like the mountains in springtime, like a walk in the rain, like a storm in the desert, like a sleepy blue ocean. You fill up my senses. Come fill me again. Come let me love you. Let me give my life to you. Let me drown in your laughter. Let me die in your arms. Let me lay down beside you. Let me always be with you. Come, let me love you. Come, love me again. You fill up my senses like a night in the forest, like the mountains in springtime, like a walk in the rain, like a storm in the desert, like a sleepy blue ocean. You fill up my senses. Come fill me again. So I'll finish off with a little Elvis. Love me tender, love me sweet, never let me go. You have made my life complete, and I love you so. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. Love me tender, love me long, take me to your heart. For it's there that I belong, and will never part. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. Love me tender, love me dear, tell me you are mine. I'll be yours through all the years, till the end of time. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. For my darling, I love you, and I always will.
Well, thanks so much, Donald. And now, instantly fulfilling our desire that he would come and play here again, we're going to get Kent back up on the stage. He's going to have the same night. Isn't that crazy? And he'll finish it off. I'll ask him to do two songs, and that'll be our evening. So once again, here is Kent. Thank you.
Thank you. so much, Ken. Thank you very much. All right, that brings us to the end of our evening. Two announcements. The first one, just a reminder of the Victor Street Rock Party. Next Saturday, July 28th. Music begins at 10 a.m., goes all the way till 8 p.m., music all day long. Hot dogs at lunchtime, some local vendors out hanging out. I said hot dogs. While supplies last. Yeah, and it's going to be really fun. Then the other announcement is I have been gifted with a very incredible opportunity to take a slightly extended vacation this year. And those of you who know what I'm talking about are co-conspirators in this whole situation, but I will be closing the shop for the month of August as it transpires. And Dave's giving me a real close-up here just to keep the pressure on. Yeah, so after the block party, there's going to be, that's the 28th, the Saturday. It'll be open Monday, Tuesday, closed August the 1st. We'll reopen September the 4th after the long weekend, which means the next open mic night is September 14th. So mark it on your calendars, as I did, September 14th, next open mic. And that is the other big announcement. And I can't thank the co-conspirators enough. Oh yes, seasonally appropriate poems, because then it's going to be fall. Which actually, I love fall. It's just what comes after fall. We'll be okay. So thanks so much, everyone, for coming out this evening. And we'll see you on the 28th of July. And then on the 4th of September, because you got to come in. And then September 4th.